The studios of KPFK Pacifica Radio in Los Angeles. This is Uprising, and I'm Sonali Kohatkar. It's Tuesday, July 28, 2015. The U.S.'s drone wars are implemented by operators increasingly experiencing PTSD. Corpwatch's executive director, Pratap Chatterjee, joins us to examine the little-known front lines of our remote-controlled wars. And Michael Gould-Wartofsky discusses his book, The Occupiers, The Making of the 99% Movement. That's coming up after the news. Joining us now to analyze today's headlines is Robert Jensen. He's an author and a professor of journalism at the University of Texas at Austin. Hi, Bob.
Hello, Sonali.
President Obama addressed members of the African Union today as part of his ongoing tour of the continent. He spoke frankly about the issues of corruption and dictatorship, saying that those African states that violated human rights, quote, may have democracy in name but not in substance. He called out specific states, including Kenya, Ethiopia, and Burundi. Meanwhile, just as Obama gave his speech in the northern African state of Libya, where his administration led a NATO war, a court sentenced Saif al-Islam, Muammar Gaddafi's son, to death. Eight other people were also handed the death penalty alongside him for the crime of killing protesters in 2011. The sentence was immediately criticized by Human Rights Watch and others, who said the judicial system is too corrupt. Libya has been racked by violence and instability since NATO overthrew Gaddafi's regime in 2011. Well, Bob, there was great irony in Obama lecturing African Union leaders while the fruits of his work are unraveling in the African nations of Libya and Egypt. What do you think?
Well, you seem to think that moral principle means the application of a moral lesson equally across all times and places. You also seem to be implying that the law is only relevant if it's applied equally in all times and places. Well, these are radical ideas, of course. And you're absolutely right. The United States, just take Egypt. The United States has been probably the greatest external impediment to democracy in Egypt for the last 50 years. If you look at Africa, you would also want to talk about history. Why do the, let's say, ethnic conflicts, why are some of the resource wars in Africa going on? Well, that has something to do with the history of European and American intervention in Africa, of course. So it's all to the good for external forces to try and help promote the forces of democracy in a country. But that requires aiding those forces, not merely giving lectures. Hence, I think your criticism is well taken.
And Democratic presidential candidate Hillary Clinton continues to campaign hard for her party's nomination. In a speech on Monday in Des Moines, Iowa, on the issue of climate change, she called for sweeping reliance on renewable energy sources, aiming for targets even higher than President Obama has promised. According to the New York Times, Clinton's strategists see climate change as a winning issue for 2016. Her campaign released a detailed plan on Sunday, but Mother Jones magazine pointed out that, as in the past, she refused to say whether or not she opposed the controversial Keystone XL pipeline, which progressives have long campaigned against. Meanwhile, a new study has identified a so-called triple threat from climate change to coastal communities living in the U.S. cities of New York, L.A., Houston, San Francisco, San Diego, and Boston. A deadly combination of sea level rise, heavy rainfall, and storm surges are now thought by researchers to be greater than previously estimated. Well, Bob, Clinton sees climate change as a winning issue. Should we take comfort in that?
Once again, I'm getting a hint, Sonali, that you think the Clinton campaign sometimes makes purely mercenary judgments about what issues to take up and what positions to take on them. I'm kind of shocked by that. But, you know, the Clinton campaign maybe should just be called the We Know No Shame campaign, and the groveling that they're willing to do to the wealthy and then the way they'll spin that for the public. You know, the climate change issue is important, and anything that raises attention is important and useful. But Clinton is right, critics of Clinton are right to say that her talk about renewable energy has to come also with a critique of the expanded exploration of fossil fuels. That means the Keystone XL pipeline. Her dodging of that issue is just a stunt. She knows perfectly well she can speak openly about it. But in addition to that, we also have to talk about conservation as well, which is important.
And finally, the latest in the ongoing series of attacks on Planned Parenthood has found that the abortion provider's website was apparently hacked into. A spokesperson from the organization told the Washington Post that, quote, extremists who oppose Planned Parenthood's mission and services have launched an attack on our information systems and have called on the world's most sophisticated hackers to assist them in breaching our systems and threatening the privacy and safety of our staff members. The FBI and Justice Department have reportedly been notified of the attacks, which come just weeks after a controversial undercover video was released by a right-wing anti-abortion group claiming that Planned Parenthood sells fetal tissue for medical research. Republican lawmakers like Senator Rand Paul have fast-tracked an attempt to defund the organization. Well, Bob, why are Congress members still taking this story seriously? It's so clear that that video was a setup and that none of their claims are truthful.
Well, there's a couple of things to always remember about these attacks on Planned Parenthood. One is that Planned Parenthood is a health provider. It's not just a place women go for abortions. They provide comprehensive health services. And an attack on Planned Parenthood is, in a lot of ways, an attack on a concern for women's health. The second thing that's so important, I think, is to always keep the discussion of abortion in the context of patriarchy. I hate to use such an old-fashioned term, that unless women have control over their own reproduction, in a patriarchal society, women are not free in a meaningful sense. And I think whatever the issue of the day, we always have to come back to that central reality about why abortion matters and why women's health more generally is the issue, not just abortion.
Bob, thanks as always for joining us. We'll talk to you again next week.
Thanks, Sonali.
My guest is Robert Jensen. He's an author and a professor of journalism at the University of Texas at Austin. This is Uprising. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Uprising. I'm Sonali Kohatkar. A U.S. drone strike in eastern Afghanistan has resulted in the deaths of five people. Press reports indicate that they were members of the Tehrik-e-Taliban Pakistan. Drone strikes in the Afghanistan-Pakistan region have sharply risen this year, although there has been little media coverage. In fact, the U.S. has increasingly relied on this form of stealth warfare, where formal declarations of war are apparently unnecessary. Individuals are placed on a so-called kill list and simply assassinated extrajudicially. And best of all, no U.S. soldiers' lives are sacrificed in the process. However, whistleblowers from among the lowest parts of the chain of command operating and deploying the drones are now coming forward to speak out. They are experiencing levels of post-traumatic stress syndrome from the remote killings that they're engaged in. Writing about this, how the U.S. drone program is not as sound as we imagine, is my guest, Pratap Chatterjee. He's the executive director of Corpwatch. He's the author of Halliburton's Army, How a Well-Connected Texas Oil Company Revolutionized the Way America Makes War. He recently published an op-ed in the New York Times called Our Drone War Burnout. He's a regular contributor to Tom Dispatch, and his new book, Verax, is about is a graphic novel about whistleblowers and mass surveillance, co-authored by Khalil Bendib. It's going to be published by Metropolitan Books. Welcome to Uprising, Pratap.
Thank you for having me, Sonali.
Well, first, is there a quantifiable increase overall in the reliance on drone warfare? I mentioned Afghanistan, but is that true overall wherever the U.S. has been dropping drone bombs?
Well, the United States Air Force, for example, which is the only force that we really have any detailed knowledge of, estimates that more than half of its actual warfare is done by drone now. So they really rely on something like 65 what they call combat air patrol. So combat air patrol is actually a, you could say, a pod, a little group of three to typically four either Predators or Reaper drones. So these are drones that operate in packs. There's one on the ground, three up in the air, and they are covering a particular area of, let's say, Pakistan or Somalia, or Afghanistan, or Iraq or Syria or Yemen, for example. And so there are 65 of these operating around the world, and they require an estimated, 186 people per pod, and therefore perhaps around 12,000 people to operate.
So essentially an army of approximately 12,000 people is now taking on a very big chunk of the U.S.'s war fighting, essentially.
I should add to that, it's war fighting, but it's also surveillance.
Right.
So a lot of what they're doing, in fact, most of what they're doing is watching areas as opposed to necessarily out there shooting missiles and killing people. A big chunk, particularly during the war in Afghanistan and Iraq, is watching of American soldiers. So they are simply providing, you know, sort of information on what they might expect, particularly obviously looking out for bombs, what they call IEDs, improvised explosive devices, but essentially are roadside bombs.
So basically observing U.S. soldiers on the ground and making sure that local rebel groups aren't planting bombs to sabotage and target the U.S. soldiers?
Exactly, yeah. So that's a big chunk of what they do. But they also, and this is no small part of it, they're also hunting people on the kill list that you mentioned. So they are looking for people in Pakistan or Syria or Somalia. Now, in theory, the Air Force simply operates in places like Afghanistan and Iraq, where the U.S. is formally at war, apparently. But the CIA, or there's been talk of JSOC, the Joint Special Operations Command, operating other places like Somalia, Yemen, and Pakistan. So in those areas, typically the CIA is monitoring, there are, in theory, no soldiers on the ground, but they are monitoring people off the kill list. Now, in reality, of course, the CIA doesn't have pilots. They use Air Force pilots. They're seconded in for a period of time. You have pilots who come in from other quote-unquote airframes, such as the National Guard, but also from other countries, like Britain in particular. Now, Britain doesn't have that many drone pilots. It's numbers in the dozens. But these individuals come and take part in the CIA war. And so you also have a lot of contractors involved. So the 12,000, not necessarily 12,000 soldiers, they involve people from Northrop Grumman, from Raytheon, from SAIC down in Southern California, who are involved in this warfare, both in the United States, in the Western United States, where most of the drone pilots are based, but also in the field launching and recovering the drones. So in Afghanistan and other places like Saudi Arabia, for example, they're believed to be bases there.
So Pratap, let's talk about what some of the people involved in the chain of command that operate drones have been telling you. You spoke with a few of them that you described in your New York Times op-ed. Who did you speak to and what has their experience been in, you know, being a part of this drone war?
So I'd like to start actually describing the chain of command in some ways, because as I said, each pod of three to four Predators involves 186 people. So, and this involves everyone from safety observers. And when I say safety observers, these are people who are making sure the planes are safe, the drones are safe, typically. The JAGs, Judd Advocate Generals, which are the lawyers who are deciding whether or not it's legal to kill somebody. Of course, the commanders, the air controllers, but in particular group of people that the group that I've mostly spoken to, which are pilots who manage the planes. And the pilots themselves have the ability to press a switch, press a button to kill somebody. So they control the missile, and they're typically accompanied by a sensor operator. That's the technical term, And the sensor operator is essentially a camera operator, and they too often have control of the kill switch. They sit together typically in an air base, typically here in the United States, in the West, in Nevada and New Mexico and places like that. But then in addition to them, even though they're the people who operate in real time and able to push the button, there's a more critical and much lower on the food chain group of individuals, and those are the imagery analysts. So these are people that are watching the video. They're almost always at a separate base. There's a famous example, a transcript of an entire drone strip, drone strike, that was obtained through the Freedom of Information Act by the Los Angeles Times. And in that case, the imagery analyst was sitting in Florida. So there's up to 14 of them sitting in a different location. And those imagery analysts are watching to see what's happening on the ground. They are also trying to track individuals and ensure that the U.S. is hitting the right person, technically not hitting civilians, women, children, or animals, say. Imagery analysts also have the ability to go into the past, so they can rewind footage from the past. They can look at other data, surveillance data. So here, think, you know, sort of Edward Snowden. You've got cell phone data. You've got all sorts of other electronic information. It could be as things from emails to banking to all sorts of other data. So they're supposed to put it together, and the intelligence analysts and the imagery analysts are supposed to say, yes, this is the correct person. And then the sensor operator guides the camera so people can see it, and the pilot pushes the button. So the people I've been talking to have been the imagery analysts, the sensor operators, and also the radar technicians. So there's one particular radar technician that I've talked to who was involved in setting up a system to monitor all of southeastern Afghanistan. So this is, he was essentially putting into place a system that was built by, if I remember correctly, Northrop Grumman, called Bacon, and he was putting it in place to ensure that the data from those planes was transmitted back from, let's say, Pakistan or southeast Afghanistan to Kandahar, and then from Kandahar back to the United States to Creech, to the pilots and sensor operators, the imagery analysts in Florida, but also to the commanders and the lawyers who are sitting in Qatar. Most of the operations were in what they called I forget the term, but we can call it the Greater Middle East, but they call it there's another term they used for the
Middle East and North Africa, MENA?
No, there's another term actually they use. It's Southwest Asia. Mm. That's the term they use. So Southwest Asia is monitored. There are several of these chaos, they call the Combat Air Operations and Space Command, if I got it correct. But the biggest one is in Qatar, the Al Ayeed Air Force Base. Right now, if you ever fly through Qatar, you fly through the main airport, and the U.S. has a huge base there, and almost all operations, the lawyers, the commanders, are based out of Qatar. The planes themselves may be operated out of Saudi Arabia and Afghanistan, but the command central, you know, where the war games are conducted, or not war games, this is real war, is out of Qatar. So the important thing is to get that video footage from Afghanistan to Qatar, where the commanders can see it, and also to the imagery analysts. And the idea is that this data comes in real time, in reality. In fact, there's a very slight delay, so decisions can be taken. And each of these individuals are communicating by instant chat. And so they're making those life and death decisions there. Now, the people that are most affected by that are the imagery analysts, the people who are watching. So the camera and plane operators are just making sure everything stays aloft, pointed in the right direction. But the people who are reviewing material, not making decisions, but reviewing material, are the imagery analysts. And what's, I think, fascinating about this is most of these imagery analysts are actually very young. They're often teenagers. They're just out of high school. They have about a year of military training, a little less, 2 months of boot camp, 9 months of intelligence or imagery or camera training. And then they're sent off to monitor whether it's Pakistan or Yemen, Afghanistan or Iraq. And they then help make those decisions as to who to kill. Now, they don't decide, but they send information back, which the pilot or the commanders actually operationalize in the sense they push the button and kill people, or what happened?
Well, one might not imagine that that action can be terribly traumatizing, is it?
It is very traumatizing particularly for the imagery analysts, and perhaps also the sensor operators and things like that. The radar technicians, of course, are out of the loop. Sean Westmoreland, who's a radio technician who I talked to, was very traumatized by that, but he wasn't actually involved in taking decisions. But he was able to watch this video. He knew the system he was part of, and in particular, after he left the military, he learned even more about what the impact of what he was doing. Now, there's another factor that's actually quite important. The U.S. military actually doesn't have enough people to go around. They don't have enough pilots, they don't have enough imagery analysts, and they are extremely short-handed. So where they probably need something of the order of 1,700 pilots, last I checked, the Air Force told me they had 1,260. So what this means is that these pilots and imagery analysts are operating double and triple time. They are working 12-hour days, 6 days a week, week in, week out. And in fact, their job, as I mentioned at the very beginning, is actually quite tedious. Their job is staring at a piece of ground for hours at a time. So they're working for a long time, but they are perhaps hallucinating a little bit. In fact, a lot of the people I talked about nightmares that they had and daydreams that during the day, one particular analyst mentioned, she just saw this thing again and again, what she'd seen before, people being hit, people bleeding to death, and that sort of thing. And we're not just talking victims, we're also talking American soldiers that they feel they will fail to support. So it's a tedious job. It's a job they're doing constantly. It's a job that they're doing also in a place that's sort of in somewhat divorced from the actual war. And that makes it even harder. Is that typically, if you're in, let's say, in the Second World War, you'd be in the trenches, you'd be with your fellow soldiers, you'd live with them.
So these folks are much more isolated, basically.
They're much more isolated, but even more than that, they're actually living with their families. So they drop off, let's say, their children to school, they go out to a game or a bar, and then all of a sudden, they're in Pakistan, 12 hours a day, making decisions, communicating with people all over the world. So this has had actually a huge impact, as much as the impact of the images of people being killed. So the overwork, the conflict between their daytime or nighttime schedule and their nighttime schedule, and the image they're seeing. So there's a 50%. There have been a bunch of studies that have been done on this, and there's a psychologist, an Air Force psychologist, at the Wright-Patterson Air Force Base in Ohio, and that's been studying this. And Dr. Chappelle tells me that there's a 50% higher rate of stress and PTSD among these pilots and regular Air Force pilots.
Now, what happens, or what is the reaction when those who are involved, either directly or indirectly, in drone killings that they realize have gone wrong? They realize that they might have killed innocent civilians, women and children. I mean, after all, the people on the kill list that President Obama signs off on every week aren't necessarily walking around with their names tattooed on their foreheads. So they have to rely on surveillance. And obviously, often things are not clear cut. The wrong person is killed, even if we set aside the morality of just extrajudicial assassinations for a minute. So how does that impact, knowing that you might have killed women and children, impact these drone operators?
So it depends on the drone operator, mm-hmm. right? And so they are, again, some of them are very young, some of them, their job is to fulfill their required number of hours and their contract. So among the people I've talked to, they've said there's a lot of people who don't really care, it's that's their job. They feel like they're in a war, they're defending America and that sort of thing. But there certainly are among perhaps a minority of these veterans that I've spoken to. This has led to them having nightmares, led to them having to seek counseling, which is not easily, or at least was not easily available from the Air Force, because the Air Force was perhaps not aware of this. And so the system also is set up in such a way that if you are an Air Force pilot and you report that you have PTSD, you're immediately taken off duty. So it means a negative hit against on your record. And so most people don't report this. So I talked to epidemiologists and they say, well, actually there's no impact because in fact, nobody's reporting it. The doctors are not seeing any difference between these pilots and regular pilots. And in fact, their trauma is less than the general population. On the other hand, Wayne Chappelle, the psychologist who did anonymous testing of actually quite large groups of people, 1,000 people at a time, and they were voluntary, found a much higher rate of stress-related issues and also PTSD. And so he's actually studying in more detail this summer the point in the kill chain where people are traumatized and the ranks. So he's looking across, starting with, you know, of course, the imagery analysts, the pilots, the sensor operators, the commanders. I don't know if he's testing the lawyers, but he's trying to figure out, not because he wants to solve the problem on the ground, but because he would like to figure out where to provide more psychological counseling. And so the Air Force can have a better way to do this. Now, do the people involved in this realize they're killing civilians? Personally, I'm not sure how they could not, because unlike a jet pilot who drops a bomb, or even a soldier in the field, who then after shooting somebody typically has to leave before they get shot again, these pilots have the luxury and the ability to sit around and watch what happens next. So the drone transcript of this event in Dikundi province in central Afghanistan is actually really instructive, the one that the Los Angeles Times, and you can find it online. When you read it, if you read it, take into account that they are pilots, they are JAGs, the lawyers, and they are imagery analysts. So watch in particular, when you read this, what the imagery analyst is saying. So the imagery analysts, in fact, are saying, up to the point of the strike, we are not sure that these are all MAMs, military age males. Hmm. In fact, we are sure that perhaps there are children involved in that. But the moment the bomb hits, what happens, unlike a typical target of a quote-unquote militant, where they, let's say, run away and hide, or they try and, I've seen video footage online where they try and hide, let's say, their weaponry. What happens is in this particular case in Dikundi, people came out and started waving, you know, clothing in the air, white clothes to surrender. They knew they were, well, in this case, the drones were watching them, but the missiles were fired by warthogs and by Kiowa helicopters. So they knew there were people overhead, and they tried to surrender. So the moment they did, then they got out of their vehicles to show who they were, because they knew people were watching. It became obvious that they were not just children, but also women among them. So the pilots, you could see, were kind of struck. They weren't apologizing, but they realized that they had screwed up. And in fact, that very night, Stanley McChrystal, the commander, U.S. commander in Afghanistan, went to apologize to Hamid Karzai, because it was clear the people they targeted were simply villagers on the way to the market. What the Air Force thought, however, because they were watching over soldiers who were close by, they thought that these three vehicles were targeting the soldiers. And this is where you can see, and General Foss, who was in charge of this, said, you know, technology makes you believe you know everything, but in fact, you might not. So what they saw was more than the villagers saw. They saw the soldiers. They were watching over them. As they watched the vehicles going towards the soldiers, they assumed that these vehicles flashing their lights on and off were signaling to each other. Right. In fact, all they were doing was trying to, because this was dark, was trying to make sure they didn't hit boulders, they didn't run off the road, that they were signaling to other vehicles. Whenever you go around a corner in rural Afghanistan, you blow your horn, you flash your lights to make sure that somebody else who's traveling at great speed at the other side doesn't hit you.
Right. Well, certainly this is a very flawed method of war fighting, and I appreciate your analysis on these aspects of it. Thank you so much, Pratap, for joining us today, and we'll post links to your work from our website.
Thank you, Sonali, for having me.
My guest is Pratap Chatterjee. He is the executive director of Corpwatch. He is also the author of Halliburton's Army, How a Well-Connected Texas Oil Company Revolutionized the Way America Makes War. This is Uprising. I'm Sonali Kohatkar. Welcome back to Uprising. I'm Sonali Kohatkar. Nearly 4 years after the historic Occupy Wall Street movement was born in New York City and spread around the world, we turn today to examine it with the benefit of hindsight. A new book by Michael Gould-Wartofsky paints an intimate portrait of the nearly two-month-long occupation of Zuccotti Park in New York, renamed Liberty Square, providing an insider's view that is informed by deep familiarity with the actors involved. Gould-Wartofsky documented the actions in detail. His book is called The Occupiers, The Making of the 99% Movement. He now joins me to discuss it. Welcome to Uprising, Michael.
Thanks so much for having me, Sonali.
Now, your book was based on a large number of interviews that you did with Occupy activists, but also from your own vantage point as a participant in the movement. And I want to begin there. How did your participation inform your writings and observations? You're not writing about it from the outside looking in. In fact, you use the words avowedly partisan to describe your views.
That's right. And my participation also extends back before Occupy and extends after what we call Occupy, and really inform my perspective on how to go about writing this book. I think a lot of the coverage of the movement, both in media and in academia, was at first kind of dismissive and then very interested and then lost interest very quickly. But what I tried to do and what this perspective of partisan observation of embedded inquiry, what that gave me was, I think, a longer term view. So to be able to situate the Occupy moment in a longer arc of mobilization and also to follow the occupiers into exile after the pepper spray and the tear gas had cleared and to try to see what endured after. So I think that the perspective of being someone who was on the ground on September 17th and kind of stayed, at the ground level of the movement, didn't try to kind of look at it from the outside looking in or from the end point looking backward, really framed it for me in a way that allowed me to tell a different kind of social history than I think in much of my field and in much of social science.
Did you know from the moment that it started that this was going to be historic? And I ask that question because you describe how in the lead up to Occupy Wall Street, of course, it didn't come out of nowhere. There were other gatherings, and you showed up to several of these thinking they would be bigger than they were and left disappointed. And so when the September 17th, 2011 occupation, the encampment began, did you have a sense that this time it would be different?
I didn't. And I thought that the context was different. I was surprised that there hadn't been more resistance and more of a mobilization since the economic crisis hit. And of course there had been to some extent, but I was curious to see where this one would lead. And at first it didn't seem like much more than 2,000 people in a park. I didn't realize that it was going to last the night, let alone 2 months and spread to 900 plus cities around the world, as it had spread from the world to New York City. So I think that's kind of what kept me in it was this was an anomaly. This was something that we hadn't seen on the left in this country for a long time in terms of the convergence of social forces that it made possible, and not just in the parks and the squares and the kind of in front of the cameras, but also in neighborhoods, in workplaces, in schools and universities. So that was something that that proved that this time was different to me.
And there was also a lot happening around the world in the lead up to Occupy Wall Street that we don't often link to what happened in Zuccotti Park. After the recession hit here in the United States, in Wisconsin, there was the uprising there. But then around the world, you saw the revolution in Egypt, the Indignados encampment in Spain. How did those broader movements and social upheavals in other parts of the U.S. and around the world lay the groundwork for Occupy Wall Street?
That's right. And Occupy wouldn't have been Occupy without that wave of mobilizations that was, you know, truly global in scale at that time. And it was a creature of that historical moment. It was a creature of that global evolution in tactics and strategy on the part of a global 99%. So, you know, it started out, of course, with the Arab revolutions and very quickly was taken up by protesters in Wisconsin who tied it to their revolt against the austerity regime there. And then, of course, the all across the Mediterranean that spring, occupations were popping up in places that they weren't expected, like Spain, places that they were, like Greece, and all of those occupations, protests and strikes, and the revolutions in the Middle East and North Africa in particular, had a demonstration effect on the occupiers that I interviewed in New York City, also in Oakland, Chicago, Atlanta, and other places. And many of them had watched and listened to and learned from the example and took as a source of inspiration and also a source of solidarity for themselves. You know, it went both ways once Occupy Wall Street emerged. So this was truly a creature of a global movement and a moment for those movements all around the world.
Among the most memorable and important messages and slogans that came out of the Occupy Wall Street movement was this idea that we are the 99%. Where did that come from? How crucial was that message, you think, to the success of the occupation?
I do think that that the message that it conveyed was crucial. It could have been, you know, put in different ways, phrased in different ways, but I think that particular framing of the problem and the fundamental dynamic, the conflict between you know, the wealthiest 1% and the rest of us basically was a very effective one. It also, of course, erased some things and obscured some things and you know, raised a lot of questions as well. But it came from poor people's movements. It's been attributed to anarchist academics and to Adbusters, to David Graeber, to various sources, but I found its first usage was actually before all that, before Occupy was even a thing, in March of 2012, and it came out of this occupation of the Capitol building in New York State by a number of poor people's organizations, housing, labor organizations, who were facing the long arm of austerity. That was then reaching, you know, all across our state and all across the country, and then it was very quickly taken up by and turned into something that, you know, was not just a statistic but a strategy, and a strategy of, you know, basically of class struggle, in a way that that did not call itself that, but allowed people to see that they shared some of their problems that they were facing with other people, who were like them, other people who were not like them. And that they could find some common ground, some common cause in that.
Now, you interviewed a large number of people, about half of whom were those who participated in Occupy Wall Street in New York, and the rest were from four other major cities where the Occupy movement spread to, but also around the world and cities around the world. Tell us about the interviews you did. I mean, that's a lot of data to draw from.
Certainly, and I would have loved to have done more, but I thought that it was important that I put this book out when I did. But the 80 interviews I did, they started out just kind of based in New York City, but I realized I was going to offer a very incomplete picture. Of course, you know, in New York City, we like to think that the world is in New York City, but you know, it required that I speak to people in these seven other cities. So I spoke to people in Oakland and Chicago and Atlanta and Philadelphia here in the United States. And then I spoke as well to people in Athens, London, and Madrid. And of course, I couldn't give a truly global picture. And I tried to be a little bit radically humble as I did this research and be clear about the limitations of what I knew, but also to you know, be able to get some perspective from people on the ground and you know, all these sites of struggle around the world.
You also archived, I understand, the communications of Occupy Wall Street, their posters and flyers, and their internal communications. So why was that important, and what did that tell you about the movement?
Right. So I think that, you know, there are certain things that you can glean from just the visual dimension of these movements by what they produce, by what the kind of materials that they actually produce and that they use to communicate. And then, of course, what they're communicating. And of course, the internal debates were very intense and very sharp. The only way you could really, access those various perspectives, and also to try to see what how people were being mobilized and how the frame and the message was evolving, was to trace those communications and to cross-check the observations that I had made, that other people had made in my interviews with other evidence that I could find, just to give a bigger and a fuller and a clearer picture, because I felt that the movement deserved that.
Now, let's also talk about the fact that when the occupation in New York City in Zuccotti Park began, which was the kind of the seed that spread elsewhere, when that began, it transformed pretty quickly. When it first started, you mentioned there were about 2,000 people, mostly young and white. What did it transform into? Very soon, there was the People of Color Working Group that formed. There were other sort of aspects, and a mini society formed that had many hallmarks of what societies need, to be fed both in mind and through food.
That's right. Those counter institutions in the park and other places that fed people, that clothed people, that sheltered people, that also opened up spaces for them to really exercise some degree of control over their own lives for once. I think that was part of the mass appeal. Another was that there were these really, really strong connections that were made between the occupiers and people who'd been doing this work for a long time in New York City and other places like Oakland that were formed at that time. Another piece of the puzzle that's often left out is the role of the movement, we could say a proto-movement for Black Lives. At that time, the Troy Davis case brought a lot of people out into the streets. That was the first week of Occupy. That was a moment when people converged from the movement for racial justice and movement for economic equality. Another moment came when people were coming under attack in Zuccotti Park and elsewhere in New York City, and this was broadcast all across the city and across the country, and people came out to defend it and effectively defended it for some time against the forces of the police and of the municipal administration. So this was a moment of convergence, that was kind of part of the power of the thing, and it also was part of what gave it its social base, which was much bigger, I think, than anyone could have anticipated on that day one, when most of us were some young white kids in a park.
Now, during the nearly 2 month long occupation, communication between a very, very large group of people and with each other would have been much more cumbersome were it not for the very interesting and unique method of communication developed right from the start, marked by the consensus style communication where people used hand signals to gesture to one another and echoed each other's words to amplify them, the so-called people's microphone. I mean, in retrospect, it might sound a little bit cheesy, but at the time, how seriously did people take these ways of communicating with one another?
Yes, they took it very, very seriously. And I think, to those who are watching, listening, who were part of this in your city, this is something that was not just, adopted enthusiastically in New York City. It was something that worked for people everywhere, across the country. The people's microphone allowed people to speak and to be heard in a way that people normally aren't spoken and heard in our society, especially those who are most historically oppressed and marginalized, those voices were echoed across the squares, and that was something that was really powerful. It also worked as a way of bonding people closer together, as a source of solidarity. It was a source of reflection. You could reflect on the words you were hearing. You were speaking them at the same time. You could also decide together with a thousand other people what, you know, what you were going to do about it in a way that made sure that those voices were heard. So, you know, it was a very effective mode of social movement innovation that I think we're still seeing and hearing today.
Was there a typical day during the occupation, or was each day unique? Did a sort of routine develop?
So at first, it was very much an improvisation in the face of great constraints and overwhelming odds. But eventually, you know, as it became clear that this wasn't going anywhere, as the chant went, "This occupation is not leaving," it was sort of more of a creature of routine, and there were routines of reproduction in the squares and counter institutions that emerged to meet people's needs on a daily basis. There were daily marches on Wall Street in the case of New York City, you know, weekly direct actions in places like Oakland and Atlanta. And so these routines, you know, were it's like an old school picket line. You could know that this was the place to go and picket. You could meet people on the picket line at this time, and they would be there every day. And it was something rather similar to that in this sense.
Now, you let's also talk about how the fact that the Occupy Wall Street encampment went on for nearly 2 months. And during that time, one very important occurrence that took place in the United States was the execution of African-American death row inmate Troy Davis. What impact did that have on the encampment?
So that was really the moment. I would argue that was the moment when it became a movement, a space for movement building, and not just for occupying, for organizing, and not just for occupying. This was a moment when thousands of people, you know, came out, and millions of people across the country participated in some way in the protest campaign to try to save Mr. Davis's life. And we failed, as we know. And this was also something that showed a lot of people that the system, the whole system, was guilty, as they said. And you know, it was an indictment of the American criminal justice system. At the same time, as a lot of for the first time, as a lot of young white people were feeling just a whiff of you know, what communities of color have been facing in this country for a very long time. And so there was a convergence in the streets that night after we marched for Troy Davis, and it was the first time that Zuccotti Park really started to look more like New York City. This was also a very important moment for people watching across the country who saw this, that, you know, the bankers who had you know, destroyed millions of people's lives were walking free. An innocent man had just been put to death by the state.
You let's also talk about the fact that while you, as a participant and an insider, was documenting this movement, of course, the world's media was covering it as well. How did the outsider's view paint this movement? You write that the Occupy phenomenon was at once made and unmade by the media industry. Can you explain?
Absolutely. So I would say that the important thing to understand is about this is that, you know, the media wasn't going to just change its ways in the face of a, you know, superior media operation that honestly Occupy had an incredible network of you know, sort of media activists, citizen journalists, people who were reporting on the movement, spreading the word, diffusing it through the networks before the mainstream media really got a hold of this thing. And once they did, it was a very quick uptake by the media. It became you know, a spectacle of all spectacles for them. And you know, in this sense, it became one of the driving forces for a lot of the things that people were doing. And unfortunately, that's not something that's sustainable over time. That's not something that's, the media in our country is not democratic. It's not responsive. It's not one that, you know, privileges the voices of the people on the ground. It has its own agenda. And of course, once the story, once the news cycle moved on, the news media moved on, and the infrastructure had not been built up to the point where it could sustain that kind of attention and that kind of audience on its own. So it depended, I think, too much on the corporate media in a certain sense for the coverage. And once that disappeared, many people were at a loss for what to do.
And before it did disappear, the movement did spread quite far and wide here in Southern California, where our program is produced. Very quickly after the New York encampment, one sprung up in Los Angeles in front of City Hall, and of course around the country. You spoke to activists from Chicago and Oakland and other places. How far, as far as you could tell, did it spread in the U.S. and around the world?
Right. So there were hundreds of cities just in the U.S. 952 cities at its pinnacle on October 15th, all across the world. And every single continent, including Antarctica, it spread very far. But I think even just as importantly as you know how far it diffused was the depth of the support, the depth of the solidarity that you saw in different places. So it wasn't just the breadth, but also the depth. I think in almost every place where an Occupy sprouted, you had a coalitional dimension to this, where you had millennial activists together with older activists. You had in some cases multiracial coalitions, especially places like Oakland, that were a necessary condition for the growth of the occupations. And you also had and I think you saw this in LA and many other places. Another prong in that coalition, which is often been undervalued, I think. And how people talk about it, but the role of homeless and jobless and working poor people who came out and found a this was a destination of last resort, but who really made something of this movement as well. So those were some common some common sources of solidarity all across the country.
Eventually, of course, the New York occupation was dismantled, as happened in other cities as well. But it couldn't have lasted forever, right? It shouldn't have come as a surprise that eventually city authorities would try to end it. And I'm wondering if there were discussions that took place during, at least in New York, during the occupation, where you were a participant, where people could see the long view that may be manifest, of what would happen to something that started out as a physical encampment, but eventually would have to transform into something else.
That's right. That's right. I argue in the book the occupation was bound to have a limited half-life. Occupations everywhere that you can't occupy forever, as you're saying. And there were all kinds of, there's a very high threshold for participation in a 24-hour occupation. So if you're asking, people with families, people who are struggling to make ends meet, to make that the only tactic available, I think you're also, you're also potentially leaving some people out who could be part of the movement. And the occupation wasn't always going to be there. Some people realized that. And tried to do something about it, tried to parlay this into mass organizing, tried to parlay it into occupier homes, tried to parlay it into efforts to engage more deeply with the political economy, with the structures in question. I think that there were some things that did endure, that did outlive the occupied squares. But I think it came too little too late in terms of thinking through how this could be channeled, moved, this anger could be moved into something that, would really was built to last.
Finally, Michael, let's talk about Occupy Wall Street's legacy. During Superstorm Sandy in New York, a lot of New York occupiers found a reason to organize, but again, that was sort of transient. And we've covered strike debt and the debt collective who are organizing, people refusing to pay back student loans, who are calling for free higher education. How would you quantify or characterize the legacy of Occupy Wall Street?
Right. So you see it, I think, you know, everywhere where young people, where workers and students and poor people are working together in a way that they weren't before Occupy Wall Street. Everywhere they're working to leverage whatever power they have against the power of the 1%. From you know the fight for 15, which actually you know there was an effort to organize a fast food workers union by Occupy Oakland even before you know the institutional unions ever got involved. There was as you mentioned, there was you know an effort to have a debt strike. Occupy Sandy, the climate justice movement, the fight for net neutrality, which scored a historic victory recently. And a lot of the momentum around the people of color working groups, you know, really was part of the wave of and the upsurge that we saw in 2012 and 2013 around the Trayvon Martin case, the Million Hoodie March, and eventually the movement for Black Lives. So there was a lot of energy and a lot of action potential in this coalition, and that remained after you know after the authorities did what they did.
Finally, Michael, do you think that there might be an encampment-like movement or encampment-based movement that we might see again in the near future? I mean, can Occupy Wall Street ever recreate itself, or has that moment in history essentially been just a moment in history?
Well, for now, it's a moment in our history, but it's one that I argue is really you know, part of a longer generational movement and a multi-generational movement. So it's something that we can't really say. It's too soon to say whether you know there will be one too many Occupies to come. I think certainly you will see more moments like Occupy because the underlying grievances are still there. The underlying conditions are very much still with us.
Exactly.
That led people to Occupy in the first place. People are still struggling with those conditions, and they're not going anywhere. You know, we speak of the crisis in the past tense, but it's still very much a crisis for people all across this country and around the world.
Well, Michael,
so I think that you know, Occupy will still be here in some sense in the years to come.
I want to thank you so much for joining us today. Michael Gould-Wartofsky is the author of The Occupiers, The Making of the 99% Movement. He writes for The Nation Monthly Review, Salon, and Jacobin. This is Uprising. Anna Buss is our assistant producer and technical director. Christian Beck is our production coordinator. Teddy Robinson and Jonathan Alexander are our audio engineers. Annie Mendoza is our social media coordinator. Subscribe to our YouTube channel at youtube.com/uprisingwithsonali. Our website is uprisingwithsonali.com. Our theme music is by Quetzal. I'm Sonali Kohatkar, host and executive producer of Uprising. I'll see you next time.